Nambus 以色列人在旷野的旅行日志，如今长存的有信、有望、有爱这三样，其中最大的是爱。哥林多前书 13:13 民数记。The Book of Nambus 民数记是出埃及记与利未记的接续。希伯来文这卷书名叫 Bamidbar， 意思是在旷野的故事。这是一卷以色列人在旷野的旅行日志。 民数记的历史发生在摩西带领以色列人出埃及后的第二年。神命令以色列人向应许之迦南美地进发。整卷书按照以色列人途径之路，可以分为以下几个部分：西奈旷野，1章负10章的前半部分；西奈旷野，巴兰旷野，13章负19章巴兰旷野；摩押平原，22章负36章。 摩押平原在即将进入迦南美地的地方，就是摩押平原。首先，1比4章记录了以属点以色列12支派各支派的人数，这就是本卷名为民数记的由来。大白话其实就是人口普查。紧接着记录了以色列选民驻扎、行军，以及12支派各营的位置。 神的帐幕安置在12支派中间，其次是祭司与利未人，往外是东西南北各三个支派，整个布局象征着12支派以神为中心而居住。5到10章记录了有关洁净的律，再次提醒以色列选民，若想与圣洁的神同住，必须要得到洁净，否则将会从神的帐幕中被剪除。在10章中，我们看到。 神通过摩西带领以色列人离开了西奈山，12支派向迦南地开进。来到11章中，以色列百姓想起在埃及有肉有黄瓜，就慢慢开始发怨言，后悔出埃及，厌恶耶和华。12章中，连摩西的哥哥和姐姐也起来反对摩西。13章百姓立在巴兰旷野安营。此时。 神晓谕摩西从每个支派中打发一个人去窥探迦南地的情况，以此拣选了12个探子。回来的探子中有10名在百姓中报恶信，说那地的人高大威猛，我们在他们眼前就像蚱蜢一样，随时面临死亡。只有约书亚和迦勒说：“我们所窥探经过之地是极美之地，耶和华若喜悦我们，就必将我们领进那地。” 把地赐给我们，那地人是流奶与蜜之地，相信神必帮助他们，足能得胜。但那10个报恶信的探子，早已在百姓中引发了恐慌和喧嚷，他们商议要另立首领，回到埃及去。面对因百姓的不信，从而发怒的神，摩西为百姓代祷，祈求神纪念与以色列祖宗所立的约，仍然赐他们应许之迦南地。 凡向神发怨言，藐视神的应许的，他们必在旷野漂流40年，他们的尸首必倒闭在旷野，唯有迦勒和约书亚才能进去。如此的惩罚本应该让百姓变得听话顺从，但16章中百姓却变本加厉。利未支派的可拉、流便支派的大贪和亚比兰联合了250个首领，反叛摩西。神使得开口。 巴克拉和一切属可拉的都吞了下去，并用瘟疫攻击了反叛摩西和亚伦的人，这才使摩西和亚伦的领导权重新得到确立。20章百姓离开巴兰旷野，继续向迦南地前行，没想境况再次恶化，百姓又聚众，向摩西争闹，又抱怨没水喝，还不如回埃及。以色列百姓，这是在挑战神的底线啊！ 话说回来，换成是人，可能早就不要这群不听话的人了，不是吗？然而，神顾念与亚伯拉罕所立的约定，对选民一再包容忍耐，百姓抱怨没有水喝，神晓谕摩西，让他拿着杖去，在百姓面前吩咐磐石出水。注意，这里是吩咐哦。然而，摩西并没有完全按照神的吩咐。 而是用杖两次击打磐石，并说：“我为你们是磐石出水， 没在百姓面前尊神为圣。于是神说，摩西最终也没有进入迦南地，只能远远地站在山上望了一眼。21章的路途中，百姓心中烦躁，怨毒神和摩西。这回神使火蛇进入百姓中间咬他们，摩西再次为百姓代祷。于是神让摩西制造一条铜蛇挂在杆子上，凡被火蛇咬的，一望这蛇就必得活。后来基督提到了摩西在旷野举蛇之事，关于这些事我们要到新约才能明白。从22章开始，百姓起行进入摩押平原。摩押王巴勒见这么一行人浩浩荡荡进入摩押地，心中惧怕，于是招了术士巴兰来，让他咒诅以色列人。但巴兰连续三次没有咒诅，反而祝福了以色列人。对此可进一步参见创世纪12章3节。实际上巴兰不仅不能咒诅以色列人，神还通过异象让巴兰预言了将来要出现的一位以色列的王。对此可进一步参考创世纪49章。故事讲到这，我们发现民数记大部分都在讲百姓如何悖逆和不信从，而不以有罪为无罪的神实行审判的时候显为公义，实行怜悯的时候彰显慈爱，一路上以玛纳鹌鹑等养育着悖逆的选民。而这巴兰与巴勒的故事将神的恩典表现得更加淋漓尽致。一方面，选民刚硬悖逆不信从的心使他们不断的抱怨和攻击神，另一方面他们却对来自巴兰和巴勒的咒诅毫不知情。神不仅暗中保护了他们，还给了他们祝福。以色列人的悖逆和不信从与神的信实和恩典构成了强烈的对比。这段历史也成了后来许多先知书、诗歌、智慧书，甚至新约书信书中反复提及引以为戒的篇章之主题。26章开始是第二代以色列人的人数数点，他们进而赢得了几场战役，有些支派甚至开始分地并设立城池。对于这即将过约旦河进迦南的民众，摩西还有最后的一番嘱咐，这我们要到申命记中才能看到。这就是我们看到的民数记的概览，以史为鉴。就如保罗在哥林多前书10章中所说的，以色列人遭遇的事是我们这生活在末世的人的鉴戒。虽然神是信实的，但若人刚硬不悔改，神便会给一颗生怕错误的心，使一切不信真理只喜爱博弈的人都被定罪。随之而来的神的审判也显为公义。
The book of Numbers gets overlooked partly because it has a really boring name,
which is a shame. In the Hebrew tradition, the book's name is Bamidbar, which means in the wilderness. And it's an epic travelogue about Israel's journey through the desert on their way to the land promised to Abraham.
Now this pilgrimage should only take about 2 weeks on foot.
But instead it takes them about 40 years.
That's crazy. It's practically half of someone's lifetime.
Yeah, it's a very long camping trip with lots of interesting stories. But let's remember, it's most helpful to back up and start with how this book is designed.
Right.
So the book is broken up into 5 sections. There are 3 wilderness locations broken up by 2 road trips that link all the pieces together.
The first wilderness section is Mount Sinai, right here on the map.
And then in the second section, they travel to a region called Paran.
A whole bunch of things happen here in the wilderness of Paran.
And then in this fourth section is Israel's road trip to Moab.
The book ends with a large section in the wilderness of Moab, right across the Jordan River from the Promised Land.
Now, through all of these sections, the storyline just flows like a gripping dramatic movie. Everything starts great, but then the trip goes horribly wrong, and it all ends with the final redemptive moment, the surprising act of God's grace.
So let's jump into the story. It all begins at the wilderness at Mount Sinai, and we've become really familiar with this mountain.
Yeah, if you remember, Israel came here after Egypt, and they formed a covenant with God here, got the Ten Commandments here, built the tabernacle here, and they've been at this mountain for 1 full year.
And now they take a census to number the people as they prepare to leave.
Right, and they're given these instructions for how to organize all those people in the camp. God's presence in the tabernacle, and then the tribe of Levi and the priests around it, and then the rest of the tribes around them. And this pattern, it's this visual symbol for how God's holiness is at the center of their existence as a people.
And they're told that when the cloud of God's presence moves, they're to pack up and travel with it.
Yeah, the Ark of the Covenant is carried by the Levites out in front, and then the tribe of Judah, and on and on. And this order is also a symbol for how God's holy presence is their leader and guide through the wilderness.
We begin the second section of the book with enthusiasm as they leave Mount Sinai and travel up the Paran. God's with them, everything's organized. This is going to be great.
But it's not great. After just 3 days on the road, the people are complaining about their hunger and thirst, and then even Moses' brother and sister start bad-mouthing him in front of all the people.
Not a great start. But now we're into the third section, the wilderness of Paran. This is where they send the 12 spies to scout out the promised land. Two of those spies come back and they're really optimistic.
But the other 10 are freaked out and they don't trust God and they go around saying, we're going to get annihilated in there. And so they start a mutiny and they try to appoint a new leader who's going to take all the people back to Egypt. And so basically they are refusing to go into the promised land and God honors their choice. He says that this generation is going to wander for 40 years and die in the wilderness, and only their kids will get to enter the promised land.
You know, this story here gets brought up many times in the Bible by different authors.
Yeah, and it always serves as a reminder that while God remains faithful to his people and his promises, he will honor their choices. He'll let them waste their whole lives if they choose to live in rebellion.
Okay, so the trip's been a disaster so far.
And it gets worse here in this fourth section as they're traveling to Moab. Even Moses has a moment of rebellion and is disqualified from entering the promised land. Then there's another rebellion among the people. It results in this snake attack. And what makes all these rebellions even worse is that every step of the way, God has been providing. He's been offering forgiveness. He's been giving them food and water and this crazy stuff called manna.
Yeah, what is that stuff?
Yeah, no idea. But in spite of all this, they keep complaining, and they say that they wish they had died in slavery in Egypt.
If I was God, I would just give up on these guys.
You would think. But that's what makes this story in the final section so surprising. Israel has just arrived in Moab, and the king of Moab, he's freaked out that this huge group of people is traveling through his land. So he hires this pagan sorcerer named Balaam to pronounce curses on them.
This guy means business.
Yeah, and so Balaam, he says, okay, I'm going to pray to the Hebrew God, and let's see what happens. And three different times, he attempts to curse them, but each time he finds that he can utter only blessing. Most surprising is the last blessing, where he prophesies that out of Israel will rise a victorious king. And this king is somehow going to be connected to God's promise to Abraham to bless all nations through this family. So here's Israel, rebelling down in the camp, totally unaware that up in the hills, God is protecting and even blessing them.
The book ends here in Moab. Israel's getting ready to go into the promised land. They count up everyone again, just like at the beginning. They're leaving the old generation behind, including Moses.
But before they leave Moses, he gives them his last words of warning and wisdom. And that speech is what the next book, Deuteronomy, is all about.